I kept trying to come back and get those. Well, good morning. Glad that you joined us today here at Lifepointe Church. If you're online with us, we want to say welcome to you as well. If you're a first-time guest with us, you can type the word welcome into your text message and send it to 660-218-1202. They'll put that up on the screen for you here at 660-218-1202. And so we want to invite you to get to know us, and we want to get to know you. Also, we had a youth weekend this weekend. We had about five or six surrender their life to ministry last night and had around five or six kids come to know Jesus. And so it's been an exciting weekend. We spent Friday night together and Saturday all day, and then as well as this morning. Now, most of them will be here second service. Some of them, their host homes had to be here, so we just drug them anyways. And so now they have a drug problem. We drug them to church. But they'll get two services this morning. We're excited about that. Guest worship leader with us today is Luke and Leah Marks, and they're expecting a baby. And it's, what's his name? What? I knew that. I was going to say it. Not Salvador. It's Connor. And so Connor, I was guessing yesterday. So Connor is on the way, and we're excited to meet Connor in a few short months. And then where's Travis at? Travis is standing in the back. He'll be up here to preach here in just a little bit. I got to tell you some stories about when I was growing up, we were at Lebanon Baptist Church, a little town on the other side of Jefferson City, McGurk, Missouri. Lebanon Baptist Church was there. My daddy was the preacher there for a while. But growing up in our youth group, I'm 45 years old. Travis is 30, almost 33. And growing up in church, there was about seven, eight of us that gave our lives to ministry. We're all preachers now. And it's pretty awesome to be able to call around and talk to those guys. And then in Travis's group, there was another six to seven guys that gave their life to ministry and are pastors. And it's just a joy. Travis has been in youth ministry for the last several years. When I first met Travis, he'd been in trouble stealing a car. And God got a hold of his life, and he has radically changed, gave him a good wife to keep him in line. And so that's really awesome. But you guys will get to hear more about him and his family in just a little bit. And it was a joy to have him here and to listen to him speak. And so we wanted him to come this morning, finish off the series that he's been doing. And it's not the I Am series that we have up here. It's actually called Disciple, but we misspelled the word disciple, and it's decibel. And so anyway, I think they chose a different picture on purpose. And so, but that's youth ministry, right? And but the kids got it, and they understand it. And so we're talking about making a difference, and God can make a difference in each and every one of us. Let's go to the Lord in prayer this morning as we get started. I know God will bless you today as we enter into this time of worship. Lord, we love you, we thank you, we praise you today for your blessings that you've given us, for this opportunity to come together, be united under one cause, that's to know you and make you known. So Father, we want to love you and love people on purpose today. God, we love you and we thank you for this opportunity to be here, and it's in your name we pray. Amen. Worship with us, if you would. Stand up.
Well, good morning, guys. Good to see each and every one of you. Thanks for joining us. All you that are watching online, thanks for being a part of the service today. Really looking forward to being with you all. As Rusty said, my name is Luke. This is my wife, Leah. You guys some of you that have been here before, maybe remember myself along with six other people, my family. We come and sing, but they couldn't be here today. But I'm excited to, anytime I get to be a part of what Lifepointe does and be with Pastor Rusty, it's always a joy. So good to see you all. We're going to worship this morning. I want to do this idea of when we worship, something that's called vertical worship. So when we're singing, we're not singing to the person next to us, not singing to us here up on the platform, but you're singing directly to the King of Kings. You're singing to the Lord of Lords. So I pray that as you worship, maybe that's just standing in your seat praying. Maybe that's coming to the altar. Maybe that's maybe linking up with someone, or that's just singing. Whatever that is for you, I pray that it's your heart and that you're just vertically doing that to the Lord as we start this morning.
Blessed be your name in the land that is beautiful, where streams of abundance blessings flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name. When I'm found in the desert place, though I walk through the wilderness, blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be your name. With the sun shining down on me, when the world's all as it should be, blessed be your name. Blessed be your name. On the road marked with suffering, there's pain in the offering, blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. You give and take away. Lord, blessed be your name. You give and take away. You give and take away. My heart will choose to sing. Lord, blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be your glorious name.
Amen. Good to me.
been so, so kind to me. And oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves in 99. And I couldn't earn it, and I don't deserve it. Yourself away.
Good. Praise him today.
Silence the boast of sin and grave. The heavens are roaring, the praise of your glory, for you are raised to life again. Oh, you have no rival, you have no equal, now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom, yours is the glory, yours is the name above all names. What a powerful name it is, what a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is, oh, nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a beautiful name it is, what a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ, my King.
Amen. Just praise the Lord tonight. I appreciate singing up here with these guys. I don't think people give a band enough credit, but Pastor Russ, you guys have like incredible talent in this church, and it's just a joy to be a part of such an awesome experience. I tell you what, I feel closest to the Lord when I'm worshiping, when I'm singing, and whatever that is for you, that's just where my heart is. That's just what I feel like I've been called to do. That's just what I love. I shared a lot of my heart with Pastor Rusty on this. Our family, when we normally travel and sing, and COVID's kind of been kind of put a damper on that. So just getting back out, seeing faces, meeting a lot of new people, seeing old friends, it's just been a joy. This next song we're going to sing, Good, Good Father. You know, I think about things going on in life, think about craziness we live in. But you know what's always constant is Jesus Christ is always constant. Our Heavenly Father is always constant. He's not going to leave us. He's not going to forsake us. And we have hope in him, so sing this from your heart tonight.
Oh, I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard a tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell that you're pleasing, that I'm never alone. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. Oh, I've seen many searching for answers far and wide, but I know we're all searching for answers. Only you provide, 'cause you know just what we need before we say a word. You're a good, good Father. Undeniable, I can't hardly hardly speak. Peace so unexplainable, I can hardly think as you call me. Deeper still as you call me. Deeper still as you call me. Deeper still into love.
Next song we're going to sing is called Paid It All. And with this song, I challenge you to really like connect with that vertical worship and just think about what God has done for you and where he's brought you from and how with his sweet blood he truly has paid it all.
Provided for those who've been captive to find a new life. all the hell-bound and hurting, broken and dirty, Lord, that's how you found me. Oh, how you changed me. Your wounds are the entrance that you have provided for those who've been captive to find a new life. All the hell-bound and hurting, broken and dirty, my hands to the Savior, whose blood does command all my worship. I worship, hallelujah. I fall at the feet of the Savior, who suffered for me. And I worship you alone.
จะได้อะไรถ้าเขาทำแบบนี้ทุกวันเราจะไม่ได้อะไรเลยไม่ได้รวยขึ้นไม่ได้ออกทีวีไม่มีใครรู้จักไม่ได้มีชื่อเสียงที่มากขึ้นเพราะสิ่งที่เขาได้คือได้แค่ความรู้สึกได้เห็นความสุขได้เข้าใจได้ความรักได้ในสิ่งที่เงินซื้อไม่ได้ได้โลกที่สวยงามกว่าเดิมในชีวิตคุณอะไรคือสิ่งที่คุณต้องการมากที่สุด
Good morning. We're excited to be here in the Lord's house.My name's Travis. Rusty did a great job introducing me. It's always hard with words to really convey how awesome I am, but I think you did a very good job. So I thank you for attempting that, Rusty. So I've known of your all's church for a long time. I've known Rusty for a long time. His mother was my teacher in school. Rusty was always one of those guys as someone who felt called to ministry. I always said, man, I want to be like Rusty, because there's something about Rusty. He loves people and he loves God. and you can't be around them for any time without hearing the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so, Rusty, I thank you for just being a way maker for the gospel wherever you go. So I appreciate that. It's encouraging to me. So thank you. But you guys, as a church, you guys probably see me and you're like, I don't even know who this guy is. And for some, that may be true. But you guys have prayed for my wife, Amanda. We've been walking through cancer for years. And Rusty has told you guys about it. You guys did a fundraiser. You guys paid for my washer and dryer, and we still use that to this day. If I smell clean to you, it's because of your all's money. So thank you for that. But more than anything, thank you guys for your prayer. And so when Rusty called me and asked me if I wanted to speak at DNOW, I was like, yeah, I want to speak at DNOW. Like, that sounds awesome. I was serving as a youth pastor, and so I worked with students for the last 9 years of my life. I have 4 little kids of myself. And at that time, I didn't know what the Lord was going to be doing in my life. I now serve as a senior pastor. This would be my 3rd week in the pulpit there, but I am with you guys, and I am excited for that. We've had a great time this weekend. Friday night when I got here, I spoke with your students just about putting their faith in Jesus Christ and what faith lived out looked like, and if they'll trust Jesus with their life, that he'll do something more amazing than you could ever imagine. And so we started the weekend, the difference, just talking about that first, God has to be the difference in you. And that starts by putting your faith. And then Saturday morning, we talked about prayer, that if we're going to be a difference in the life of people, that it's going to be driven by prayer. That we could be the best person we could ever be, but if we're not bathing every step we take in prayer, that nothing's going to happen. Rusty could be the best speaker, the most fluent speaker, the most energetic guy ever, and if it's not bathed in prayer, nothing's going to happen. And so if we want to make a difference, we're going to have to bathe it in prayer. And then last night, we got together, and I told your students that there's only 2 choices they have in life. They can either choose to follow Jesus, or they can choose to not follow Jesus. They can make much of God, or they can make little of God, but they've only got 2 choices. And the reality is that if we choose not God, that we choose hell. That without Jesus Christ paying the price for our sins, we spend eternity in hell. And so today is like the climax, the final time together. And I get to pack up and go home after this. And so anything I say that you don't like, just come by Rusty's office Monday and spend time with him and let him know. But I do hope that we leave here encouraged together to make a difference for the kingdom. That you guys leave here and you hear the gospel, and if you don't know Jesus, that today you would enter into a relationship with him for the first time. I know we've got people joining. Rusty's been telling me just about what the Lord's been doing through your all's online presence. So if you're joining us online, I hope that you hear God speak to you, and that today is a time that you enter into a relationship with Jesus Christ. They've got a number that they throw up. I've got the giving number. This is not the 660-218-1202. If you text something to that... Welcome. If you text welcome to that number, someone from here in the church is going to plug in with you guys and help you start to walk through what that looks like. And because what we don't want to happen is for you guys online to make a commitment to Jesus and to no one hear about it, because Satan is going to attack you when that happens. And we want God to make a difference in your life and those around you. So whether you're in here with us today or you're joining online, we want to hear from you guys after this. But so we've been in the Sermon on the Mount for the last 2 messages. We've jumped from the beginning to the end, to the middle, to everywhere. And today, this morning, we're going to be in the very beginning of the Sermon on the Mount. Now, the Sermon on the Mount is what any preacher seeks to do. Seeks to have just the best sermon in his whole life. And that's what I believe Jesus has here, is the best sermon that you're ever going to hear. It's composed from Matthew chapter 5 all the way through chapter 7. It challenges us to move from where we are to where God's calling us to be. And he starts it by just these blessed statements. Blessed is this, blessed is this. And the gist of it is this, is that when God calls us and shows us something, it's completely counterculture to what we would think. That when you walk into Christianity, the world's going to tell you one thing, but the Word of God's going to tell you something totally different. So he starts with this, is don't be so alerted that the world's going to absolutely hate you. And then he gets to where we're going to be at today there in chapter 5, verses 13 through 16. And he says this, "You are the salt of the earth, but if the salt should lose its taste, how can it be made salty? It's no longer good for anything but to be thrown out and trampled under people's feet. You are the light of the world. A city situated on a hill cannot be hidden. No one lights a lamp and puts it under a basket, but rather on a lampstand, and gives it light for all those who are in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, so that they may see your good work and give glory to the Father in heaven." Now, Jesus is 30-ish years old at this time, probably just 30, and very start of his ministry. They say he's in northern Galilee whenever he speaks this, at the hill of some plateau. You could probably go visit it today. I've never been there, but I'm sure it's a place you can go see. And as it goes, he's standing here and he gets his closest people. We call them his disciples, and that's just a fancy term for the followers of Jesus Christ. And so his disciples gather with him, and I like to just paint a lot of pictures in my head of what it looks like, but I see Jesus standing here and talking to this group of men. And as Jesus is talking all through his ministry, people start to pick up like, man, what this guy is saying is so different than what I've heard. And so a gathering starts to take place, but Jesus is speaking to his disciples. And he wants his disciples to understand that what they're doing in life is going to be very important. And so he tells them that they are the salt. So if you have that following guide with you, or if you're following us online, it should say we are blank. And that first one's going to be we are the salt. Now, I like salt. Anyone who doesn't like salt, I don't know what to say to you. But salt has a lot of characteristics. One of the things salt does is it preserves things. Both my parents worked for Burger Smokehouse. And so as a kid, like, I remember going to Burgers and we would prepare hams. We would sit them up to be cured and we would hang them. Well, actually, someone else would hang them because they were too heavy for us. But one of the things you would do is you would put salt all over these hams so that it wouldn't rot away. So that's one thing salt does. It preserves. But it also adds flavor. I figured that'd at least get one amen. If you go through the drive-thru or if you order fries and you get drove away and you reach in the bag and you go to throw a French fry in your mouth and it has no salt in it, how disgusting is that? I mean, sometimes it's happened a couple times. I just want to park my car in the front window and be like, what are you doing to me? I ate that. Like, that's disgusting. And so you're sitting there, you're like trying to dig dry potato out of your mouth, and you're throwing it, and you're like, this is the most grossest thing I've ever had. Now, I don't want to be mean to those of you who maybe enjoy French fries without salt. I just want you guys to be prayed for, and that you would understand the error in your way. So it preserves, it adds flavor, it also has a medicinal purpose. If you've ever had a toothache or something, they'll recommend that you make a little salt water mixture and you rinse it through your mouth and you kind of clean that out. If you're having sores on your feet, they may recommend that you soak your feet in like an Epsom salt bath. And so as I was reading about it, I was like, yeah, that all makes sense. But then I started reading about something that I was like, this is one of the craziest things I've ever read. When babies used to be born, they would take salt and like honey, and they'd make like what we would call now like a scrub. And they'd make a scrub, and they would take the baby, and they would clean it, clean up all the excess stuff that a baby comes out with. And if the baby maybe had any sores or anything, it would clean the sore. And I'm like, man, that is profound. I've got four kids, and never once have I been standing there in the hospital, and the doctor comes in with a salt shaker trying to like get salt on my baby. I would believe that would be called assault on a child. There you go. My wife begged me for 2 days not to say that to you guys. Assaulty. Oh, goodness. It also creates thirst. If you guys ever eat peanuts, I mean, you can't eat a peanut and then not get thirsty. That's why they put them out at restaurants, so you'll keep ordering soda, or you'll keep wanting refills, and so that you will have a thirst. There's an old saying, you may not be able to make a horse drink, but if you put salt in his oats, it will make him thirsty. Salt creates thirst. So when Jesus says this, that we are the salt of the earth, there's a whole, I mean, now the disciples aren't thinking about McDonald's, but they do understand what salt does. And so there's a whole lot of things going on that Jesus could be trying to tell his disciples here, that he could be trying to tell us this. But what Jesus is concerned about is not the chemistry of salt, not that it creates thirst, and not that it makes food taste better, and not that it has a medicinal purpose, but that salt will prevent the decay of something. And that as Christians, that we're called to prevent the moral decay of this world. Jesus wants us to be agents that he uses to prevent moral decay wherever you are in life, wherever your students are in life. Now, there is a school of thought that people think that when salt loses its taste, it's thrown out. That Jesus is, is warning his disciples that if you stop being effective for the kingdom, that no longer is eternity yours. The Bible teaches us, guys, in John 10:28, that I give them eternal life and they will never perish. No one will snatch them out of my hand. There's no risk of losing your salvation here, guys. That's not what Jesus is saying. But what Jesus is saying is that when Christians fail to resist the moral corruption of the world, that we become ineffective for the gospel. That we'll move, we'll compromise in the name of being relative so that we could reach someone. And in the end, what we end up doing is becoming ineffective for the gospel of Jesus Christ. Christianity can make its peace with the world to avoid corruption or avoid persecution, but in the end will render itself useless. See, Jesus wants us to understand that Satan wants to change the salvation of not us. He can't change your salvation. He can't pluck you from the Father's hand, but the truth is this. He can change the eternal destination of your children. He can change the eternal destination of those who are going to come after us that have not heard the gospel of Jesus Christ. If we'll bend on the gospel, he can change the next generation. He can make sure that your grandkids don't hear about Jesus Christ. If we'll start to bend on the gospel, if we stop being salty for the kingdom of Jesus, he can change what happens. He can greatly change what Lifepointe does in the kingdom of Jesus in Sedalia if we'll move on the gospel of Jesus Christ. Now listen, you guys are different than the church I come from. Rusty said I could wear jeans. I was like, I can wear jeans. That's awesome. Like, I'm gonna rock my jeans. I don't got my slacks on. You guys are different than the church I come from. But I'll tell you what can't be different is the gospel of Jesus Christ cannot be different. Our music can be different. The way we paint our walls can be different. But the gospel of Jesus Christ cannot be different one bit. We can't move one inch on the gospel. The world is going to call us to move. The world's going to challenge you guys to move. It's going to challenge church not to be important. It's going to challenge the blood of Jesus Christ. And we cannot move on the gospel of Jesus. Or this is the thing. You might as well become an event center. You might as well just give up and quit calling yourself a church. Because if we move on the gospel, we become very ineffective. And so the first challenge is this, students. If you guys want to be a difference in your schools, if you want to be a difference to your peers and the people you see on the ball team, make the gospel the most important thing that you can be. Whenever you guys stand up, and you may not know all the answers, but know this, that it takes the blood of Jesus to pay the price for your sin. That there's no way to heaven except through Jesus Christ. And if you don't move on that, you guys are going to see a mighty movement take place in your life. When we compromise, we become worthless to our families. We become worthless to our communities, to our jobs. Those who are called to be the very change that the world needs become something that God's unable to use. Satan is coming after us full fold. As a church, I mean, you guys can flip on the TV. You guys can see that there's rules and legislations coming out of the government that are seeking to destroy the very church of Jesus Christ. It won't happen, guys, if we don't move on the gospel. It won't happen if we're unwilling to let the world take away our saltiness. Satan's seeking to steal, kill, and destroy, and he'll use anything that he can to deter the world. He'll use the evangelism. He'll use wanting to reach people for the gospel to deter the gospel. That if we'll just become a mile wide but an inch thick, maybe we could reach more. You know, if I won't say sin or hell, like maybe more people will come. You know, if Rusty talked just a little more about the love and the goodness and a little less about hell, like if you just not say hell, like just keep that out. Like, well, maybe some more people will come. But the truth is that it is the gospel that makes people's lives change. Now, the love is why God came and sent his son Jesus to die for us. I mean, that is the gospel. It was driven by love, but it was so that we could be rescued from hell. Can you imagine how dark society would be with no God? I feel like the world is dark now. I feel like it's we homeschool, not because we're anti-public school, but because, man, the world's dark. I got a 13-year-old girl that I'm so scared of what the world is throwing at her so fast. And I'm trying to combat it and just be like, no, you're beautiful this way. Like, you don't need this. Like God's made you wonderful. I've got two boys that I'm raising. I'm like, this is what being a man looks like. It's not what the world's going to sell you on. And I'm so scared that we're going to raise our children in a culture that is a godless society. And some of you guys are sitting here and you've got many more years on me. And you're like, man, if you only knew how bad it's already gotten. 50 years ago that this would have not taken place. I've read some history books. I know that we're on a moral decline. And so God says, be the salt, but then he says, be the light. And so the second thing you guys should see is as we are, and it should say, we are the light. It says, you are the light of the world, talking to his disciples. A city situated on a hill cannot be hidden. No one lights a lamp and puts it under a basket, but rather on a lampstand, and it gives light for all who are in a house. Like salt, light, again, has a lot of different characteristics. I wear glasses, as you can see, and I shouldn't drive at night, but I do drive at night a lot. And these new cars that they're making are just, I mean, completely ridiculous with how bright the lights are. I mean, I like to drive behind them, so then when my little dinky headlights, like, aren't lighting up nothing, like, I'm like, man, it's daylight in front of these people. And so sometimes I just think I should turn my headlights off and tuck in behind them and hang out. But you guys ever been driving down like a back road and like you've not seen anything, and then all of a sudden this car pops over the hill and it's not their brights, but for some reason you're so convinced that the manufacturer has placed suns inside those and you're like, oh my goodness, it's just ridiculous. I mean, how bright it is. It disrupts darkness. Christ followers, we're called to reflect this. Jesus says that I am the light of the world. We're called to reflect this light of Jesus Christ. Now, we do a lot of traveling, and like I said, I have these four young kids, and we go to Florida a lot for my wife's treatment, and just depending on really what time of day we leave, we may go through St. Louis and then cut down, but a lot of times we like to leave like super late at night, like 1 a.m., let the kids stay up as late as they want, and then so when we hop in the car, they'll pass out. And then I drive through the night. I don't even have to worry about telling them to stop fighting or really stop one kid trying to lick another kid. It's ridiculous. We've actually told our kids, don't lick the dog. Like, if you got kids, you're like, yeah, that's not the weirdest thing I've ever had to say. So, we start to travel at night so that we don't have to fuss with the kids. And we'll get on these back roads and like you're just driving and you're starting to think like, well, you know, I could use some gas or maybe I'm getting thirsty, like I could stop. And so afar you see like these bright lights. And you're like, oh yeah, we're about to come up on a city. And when we get here, I'll stop and get gas. Like I'll get an energy drink. I'll stretch. And it looks like you're coming up on Kansas City. And what you come up on is this town that's got one stop sign, one light that lights up the little corner store that's not been opened for 45 years, and it's an absolute ghost town. And you think, how in the world did this town, when I was 30 miles back, look so huge? I must have misunderstood it. Like, I must have been looking somewhere else. And I've gotten on my map and, like, zoomed out and said, man, did I miss it? And I didn't miss it. These little houses in the middle of nowhere disrupt darkness that's from miles away. You're like, man, this is a huge city. That's the power that light has. That in darkness, it just expands and darkness is dispelled. It can no longer stand in the presence of light. Now, you guys all have houses, and if your wife is like mine, guys, if you turn on a light in the middle of the night to go to the restroom, like, that's a no-go. Like, you need to really learn to brave the land. And so I've gotten good. Like, I'm like a young Columbus when it's nighttime. I can make it from my bedroom anywhere without getting hurt. But I'll tell you what happens is my kids leave stuff out purposely. I really think so. Like, I think they say, oh, man, Dad's going to be getting up in about 3 hours. If I place this toy right here, whew, it will really get them. And it's always those toys that got lights. And so not only when you hit it, like, does it hurt, but it also lights kick off. And like, my wife's like, what are you doing? And I'm like, oh gosh, I'm so sorry. And so you try to navigate it. And so what I start to do now is I sleep with my watch on. And I don't even have to like turn it. It's got a flashlight, like it's pretty bright, but I don't even have to turn it on. Because a little bit of light in a dark room makes it look like the whole place is lit up. And so this is what Jesus is saying, is guys, you guys are going to live in the darkest place ever. You guys read the newspapers. The world is dark. What people are doing in our world is very dark. The things coming down the pipeline are very dark. The things coming out of people's hearts, it's been very dark. And what needs to take place and what must take place is that we must be the light in this world. That Christians cannot retreat. We cannot pull away. Christians, we must be running for the school board. We must be running for the city, municipalities. We must be Christians who say, okay, like the life is dark, world is dark, but I'm going to be a light. I'm going to stand up, which means students, to you guys, when you guys are living life and you're going to school and it's a dark place, don't say, man, I'm not going to say nothing about Jesus. This is scary. It's the best place to say something about Jesus, because you guys start to do Bible studies. You guys start to pray. I'll tell you what happened is the light starts to grow bigger. And your peers will say, man, something's going on. Something different's taking place. And God's going to start to use that. You guys, when you're at work and you're thinking, like, I clock in at work at 8 o'clock and then I go home at 3 o'clock. And while I'm at work, I got my work hat on. I'm work guy. And you never take the gospel into the workplace with you. Man, what a shame it is that for Christians, we bought into this lie that we're called to be Christians on Sundays and Wednesdays, when God's calling us to be the light every day, every step to be the light. He says, I'm the light of the world. Everywhere you go, you're going to take me with you. So we're called to be the light. And here's the thing. It's because we're called to be the difference. The whole week's been about meeting the difference and about how prayer is going to help drive the difference. But it comes down to us being the difference. Jesus does something miraculous in our life. When we accept him as our Savior, the Bible teaches that his Spirit comes, dwells in us, empowers us as believers to do this exact thing, to be the light. Now, the good news is this. We're not called to be the Savior. We're not called to make the payment for a single person's sin. All we're called to do is to shine a light, to be a mode for this light to shine through. But that means that we have to let God use us wherever we are, whatever we're doing. We have to be willing to let God's light shine through us. That's why he says you don't take something and place it over the lamp. You are over the light. Like, you let that light shine wherever you guys go. God's called us out of Egypt. That's something I've been telling the students is God's called us out of Egypt for a reason. He's called you guys out of darkness for a reason. I drove around Sedalia. I grew up in California, and so I'm familiar with the area. Sedalia is a hurting community. There's people that you could throw a rock, and you could find someone that's hurting. The location of this church is awesome, because you guys got missions just right out your front door. People that are passing in this idea, this cafe. Amazing that people would be a funnel of traffic coming in, thinking they're going to get physically fed, and what they could meet is someone that's spiritually going to feed them for the rest of their life. It's crazy, but we've got to be the light. But darkness wins this all too often. Darkness is winning the battles in our school system. Darkness is winning the battle in our judicial system. It's winning the battle in the White House. It's winning the battle really, anywhere you look, darkness is got a good hold on the world. And the truth is this, is that this is Satan's playground. He came and challenged Jesus Christ, or challenged God. He was thrown out of heaven and created this void that took place. And so what happened is we were created in Genesis, and this is now we're going all the way back to the beginning, and in Genesis, God created Adam and Eve, and Satan shows up as the tempter, and he tempts Adam and Eve, and they decide at that moment to sin. And at that moment, right there, sin entered the world, sin and death entered the world, and it's completely shattered everything. It shattered home lives, it shattered our government systems. Everything that you can think of is affected by sin. Now, 2,000 years ago, and the band's going to come, and they're going to play, and you guys should have got a glow stick with you guys. Just hang on to that. Don't break it. But 2,000 years ago, this guy named Jesus Christ, fully God, fully human, hanging out in heaven, comes to this world, born of a virgin birth, lives a life of absolutely no sin at all, comes into his public ministry, and he serves in public ministry for 3 years. Until they decide that they're going to kill him. He stands on what I would consider one of the biggest mockeries of a trial that you could ever read about. The Bible records that they took him and they gave him 39 lashes. And as they whipped him, guys, it's not just a small whip. It was the cat of nine tails. It had things braided into it that when it would hit, it would latch into his skin. And when they would pull it back, his skin would be ripped away. And they did it 39 times with the belief that on the 40th one, he would have died. And so after 39 times, they make him up this, they give him this robe and they drape it over him. And as you can imagine, if your flesh had been ripped off your back, as it would start to dry, it would start to heal to this robe. And they made him a crown of thorns, and they started to mock him, and they started to punch him and spit on him. And the Bible says that he took a cross, and they told Jesus that he's going to carry his own cross to this hill. They call it Golgotha Hill. And so he carries his own cross, but he didn't have the strength, so someone had to help him. And as he gets it up there on the hill, and they get there, and he's standing in front of all these people who are making fun of him, laughing at him, just making a mockery of who we would call our Savior of the world. And they take his one hand, they say the Bible records, and they start to drive a nail into it. And whether you believe it was the wrist or the hand, it doesn't matter. What matters is this, is that they drove the nail through Jesus Christ. And then they took his right hand, the Bible says, and they drove it through the nail, the other side. And he hung on the cross like this, and they took his legs, and they crossed his legs, and they drove a nail through that. I believe Jesus hung on the cross completely naked in front of everyone. They raised him up on this cross, and on each side of him, the Bible records that there was two thieves. And as you can imagine, one of the thieves is making fun of him. And the other thief says, do you not know who this is? This is the king of the king of the world, that he's came to take away the sins. He stands on this cross unjustly. We're standing here because we're criminals. He stands here for no reason at all. The Bible says that Jesus says, today you'll be with me in kingdom and or in paradise. And that guy gets to partake in what takes place. And so it says he hangs there for hours. Now, science has revealed to us that what's taking place as Jesus hangs there is as he drapes, that the fluid starts to fill up his lungs. And so he stands there or hangs there and he starts to suffocate. And so he would muster up the strength, if you could imagine how hard that would be, to raise himself up so that life could happen a little longer. Eventually, the body, the muscles wear out and he's unable to do it any longer. And so he dies. They make a spear and they drive it into his side, and it says that fluid flowed out of there, showing that his lungs had fully filled up with fluid. He was dead. Now, this king of the world, this God who left heaven, dies on this cross. And you think, man, that's horrible. But it gets even worse. He didn't even have a tomb. They didn't have anywhere to lay him. He had to be buried in a borrowed tomb. And the religious leaders of the time are so nervous about this following that's taking place, these disciples, that they put these Roman guards in front of the tomb and they roll this rock in front of it and they put him there. But something crazy happens. 3 days later, it says that the rock was blown away, that there had to have been like almost a rattling that took place inside this tomb. And Jesus rose from the dead. Defeated death, defeated Satan. See, back in Genesis, when Satan thought, like, okay, I've got it figured out. I'll tell you right here, in the story is when Satan really thought he had defeated Jesus, whenever he was laid in that tomb. But at this moment right here, when Jesus rose from the grave and defeated death, he did it for you and I. He did it so that your sons and your daughters and your grandkids and my grandkids and your neighbors could have everlasting life. Hung naked in front of everyone, crucified for us. Not so we could hang out and play church. Not so that we could come here and have a good time or get a donut or a good coffee, but so that we would be the light of the world. That we would take the story of Jesus to our workplaces. That we would take the story of Jesus Christ to our schools. That we would take it across the road to our neighbors. You guys want to see darkness and wickedness cast out of our culture faster than you could ever imagine? Get serious about being the light when we leave this place. Get serious about opening your Bible outside of Sunday and Wednesdays and doing it in front of people so that people would know, like, you are a Christian. Become salty. Now, we're going to kill the lights, and I understand it's going to get dark in here. The band's going to start playing, and I want you guys to just bow your heads. I want you guys to start to think about some of the things in the world that you guys understand is darkness. I want you guys to really think about the darkness that surrounds you, the darkness that you can look out your front door and see. Students, for you, it may be that you're seeing an all-out war against what genderism is in your schools, and Satan seeking to destroy what God has designed. Husbands, maybe that it's the darkness is that you're not loving your wife the way God's called you to love them. Maybe it's that you're not being the spiritual leader that your family needs you to be. Maybe you come into church on Sunday, but you're not really living out your faith when you get home. Ladies, maybe it's that your family needs to see you on your knees before God praying and just asking that the Lord would intervene in the life of your children. You guys, I don't know what darkness looks like in your life, but I know what darkness looks like in my life. And this is what I know to be true, that if we want to see God move in the lives of what's around us, that we've got to get serious about being the light. And so you guys are going to have these glow sticks in your hand. And with your guys' head bowed, I just want you guys, if you really are serious about being the difference, about being a light in your community, about being the light in your school, I just challenge you guys to break that stick open. And you guys can hear the sticks breaking. And guys, and what that sound is you guys saying that you're serious about what God wants to do through you guys. This weekend wasn't about coming and just hanging out and having fun, but this weekend was about seeing God do something radical in the life of your students. And so, guys, I'm going to pray. We're going to sing one more song. This altar is going to be open. And this is what I challenge you guys to do. See, breaking the stick was easy. But I challenge you guys to get out of your seat, to come down to the altar. And I challenge you to pray that God would use you to be a light in your communities. That you guys would be the saltiest person for the kingdom of Jesus Christ ever. So here's the thing. If you broke the stick, everyone sees it now. It's broke. But leave your pews. Come down here and pray that God's going to move in a mighty way. Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank you for today. Lord, we just thank you that you left heaven and came and died in our place. Lord, that you didn't see it as something to be held on to, Lord, but you loved us enough to die on that cross for us. Lord, I just thank you that you defeated death. Lord, I thank you that in defeating death, you did it not only for me, but you did it for everyone. And Lord, I just ask that we would be so serious about being the light. Lord, that we'd be so serious about being the salt of this world. It's going to be scary. It's going to be challenging, but we know through your spirit, we can make a difference for the kingdom. Or so as we sing, we just love you, and it's in your son's name. Amen.
Stand with us. Y'all come. You come.
Lord, I come. I confess. Bowing here, I find my rest. Without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh, God. Runs deep, your grace is more. Where grace is found is where you are. And where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. Song to rise to you. When temptation comes my way, when I cannot stand, I fall on you. Jesus, show my hope and stay. God, how I need you. righteousness, oh God, how I need you.
Somebody say amen. Amen. Y'all can be seated. We're going to have just a moment here. If the guys that are going to take the offering would come this way. And I know that Everett usually is up here. I want to go ahead and also, do anybody know a graduate or somebody that's in our church that's going to graduate soon? All right, sweet. There's a few of you. So we need to get pictures, bios of you. And if you would, on your way out the door, grab one of my business cards. It's on that last table on the way out the door. It's got a big thing up there that says ministry opportunities. And my card is on there. I need you to grab that so you can text me pictures and a bio, because we're putting together a video for our senior Sunday that's going to be the 23rd. And we have a gift for our seniors. And we want to tell you we're proud of you. We're excited for you and what God's going to do in your future. So if you would send that, if you're a parent of a senior and you know they're not going to do it, especially dudes, because they are not good about getting stuff out to me, but make sure you get it to me. I don't want to miss out on them. And if you can do that by May the 8th, that's the first or second Sunday of May or Saturday of May, make sure and get that to me by then so that I can get it made up. Inevitably, every year somebody forgets and I have to remake the video 7 times, and hopefully we can do it in a one take this time, this year. But we're excited about what God is doing in your future and your life. I want to say this. Our youth ministry has grown immensely this year. It's been amazing to watch it. And, you know, being that salt and light, Travis, those students that have been willing to stand up and all these guys here and say, I love Jesus, this is why it's growing. It's not because we're cool. It's not because our church is cool. It's because Jesus is in your world and in your life, and we're excited for you and excited to see what God's doing in you. Where's our guys? Oh, there you are. Let me pray for you. Everett, do you have more announcements or anything that you need? Because I'll forget everything. Family camp's coming up. Yeah. Okay. Yep. Yep. Yeah. Awesome. Yeah, up here. Pray.
Father God, I thank you for everybody that showed up today, and we thank you for the marks that we did have, and we thank you for their blessing that they gave us and the gift that you gave them. We thank you for our guest speaker and pastor. We just want to pray over him and his family as he goes forward with his ministry and spreading the gospel. We ask that you bless this offering and allow us to use it in the community to help people that need it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. So just another, he was making mention, and I don't know if those online could hear us or not, but we do have some space left for tents or some RV spots still for family camp coming up the last Friday and Saturday of July. If you'd like to do that, you can see me about that as well. And we're glad you were here. God bless you. Hope to see you again next week. As soon as they come past you there with the offering plate, you're welcome to leave. God bless you.